come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello. Welcome to Cinema Royale. I'm your super duper host, Mike Mixtape. And this is yet another episode of good, glorious film discussion. Tonight we're going to talk about films based on comic strips, but before I get into that, let's talk me introducing to you guys my awesome co-host and a special guest of ours, which I'll talk about later. First up, we got Matt Brunet, also known as Animat.
Hey guys! I might be a little more relaxed, maybe not as crazy as usual. I came back from the gym today, so, you know, just, like, my body needs to relax. My body needs to redeem myself after going through the immense crap that it had to go through.
Good.
Good for you for being able to do that, because I can't. I'm lazy.
Oh, Matt's going to get stronger and stronger. He's going to bust those DVDs harder stronger next time. Than you.
I'll just hold up the DVD. Is there anything so far?
It's coming.
There's always
that's
been
a reference
something.
To self. I don't know my
oh, jeez.
I can't. There's
that's
not
how me. You do it.
Strong like booty.
I don't even work out.
Since when do you lift?
Show damage. I think she'd like that.
And next to Matt is James Sullivan, also known as Homitude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by, well, shit. We have, we here at Cinema Royale offer our condolences out to the folks over in Paris.
Oui, on espère pour la meilleure pour les personnes de Paris, c'est vraiment tragique le fait que il y a des centaines de monde qui sont morts, donc on offre nos respects puis nos prières au monde du Paris.
I have no idea what you just said, but I'm sure the ladies found it very, very sexy.
And I wholeheartedly agree with the sentiments that I believe you are sending out to everyone, all of our French-speaking viewers.
Hey, it's not every day that I'm able to let out my French abilities, so...
Yes, so if you understood that and you're French, good for you. I don't know French. Next up, we have Mia.
I'm a bunny, not a cat, but I don't have a bunny hat. But I have a kitty hat and stuff, so
good
luck to do.
Yes, and our guest tonight, he's a very well-renowned YouTuber who specializes in comic strip stuff. He reviews them. He's met a lot of people in the business, and he's here tonight. He hosts The Punchline. He's the comic strip critic, John Weber.
Yeah!
Hello, everyone. A well-renowned YouTuber. You are using that statement very liberally, but I want to thank you for inviting me on. Thank you for thinking on me. I know that a lot of my viewers are wondering where I've been. I've been taking a bunch of certification courses, actually. This is just half the stuff I had to read in the past couple months, so I've been busy, everybody. Thank you for all your patience. Hopefully this gets you a little bit of a fix in the meantime. I
yes.
do have big plans for the next episode when I come back. So we're going to be having fun.
Yes.
Oh, that's going to be exciting.
Yeah. So I thought this would be a good filler for your audience. Really good filler. Since
actually,
you don't...
the next episode of The Punchline is going to be the comic that tonight's movie that I'm talking about. So the movie I'm talking about, that's the comic I'm doing for the next episode. So teaser.
All right, so let's start off this discussion about comic strip-based films, and I had a hat on the side here full of our names, and actually the first person going is Matt.
Oh, me?
Yep.
Okay, now let me just start off by saying that, James, do you remember when we did that video in the Your Top 10 Scariest Disney Moments? No, not Disney moments, so like your scariest moments in childhood?
Yes.
Yes, and I revealed something huge, that in my past, I was a gigantic fan of Garfield, and that's where my interest, like some of my interest in the comic, quiet you, anyways, I was a huge fan of Garfield, and like that's how I got interested in a bit in the comic strip world, so I knew a bit of like some of the other stuff that's been going on as well, so like I have been reading the comics left and right, and then well, nowadays my interests have fallen off, but it really got me invested down to the point like I even loved like a lot of the TV show, and I adored the specials; they were fantastic.
Oh yeah.
But then one day, I saw there was. I thought I would be excited. But even at my young age, where no better, I didn't have the critical mind that I have now, it just didn't work. It's just, it was that good. I'm referring to the 2004 Garfield. And,
oh, no.
I will admit that it's been years since I haven't seen it, but it wasn't until the Nostalgia Critic review of Garfield when I rediscovered that movie. And my god.
Matt, you didn't see mine? I did it first. I have reviewer dibs.
I know.
Go to youtube.com/chemistrycritic and check it out.
My sincere apologies. But, no, but the thing is with Garfield, it's just that nothing seems right, and there's nothing about it that feels like Garfield at all. It's like the writers and the director did not have a clear understanding of what really made Garfield so relatable and so special. It's just like, they think it's just a wisecracking cat. There's a lot more to it. That and also, a lot of the characters, they do not feel like who they are at all. Like, when I remember
that's
when I
actually,
first...
Yeah? That's actually what I was going to say is, the only character who feels even remotely similar to the comic strip character is actually Garfield. John is completely different. Liz is a vet, and that's her only character trait. Maybe. And I would never have known that movie Odie is supposed to be Odie unless they actually said his name Odie. He's a completely, completely different character. It's astonishing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I think one of the
It's a real dog. That's such a shame.
I think one of the worst is actually verbal. Because, like, we all know the little bit of Nermal, like, the world's cutest kitty cat and stuff like that. But in here, he just seems like a bud on the street. It's like, and the worst, I think it's even the voice. It's like, because in the animated show, like, they would use a female voice for Nermal. But in this, it's like, it's completely different. He sounds more like, how can I put this, a street cat. Like, Nermal would just come up, yo, Garfield, what's up, man? Hey, did you see the milkman pass by today, man? It's like...
How do you do, yeah, fellow kids?
Yeah. Comic Normal is annoyingly cute. Movie Normal feels like a doofus.
Mm-hmm.
Not an annoyingly cute doofus, just like an annoying doofus.
Yeah, and the one thing I have noticed, even back as a kid, what's actually interesting is that the story itself... I noticed that there is a bit of a pattern that's a little bit similar to the 1980 special Garfield as Himself, where, like, Odie is the new dog, and they, like, pretty much Garfield and Odie would suddenly get lost, and Odie's almost threatened to be taken away, in a way. But this one, like, in the movie, it's a lot more, it's, like, a lot more tame, a lot of it makes no sense, and, like... It's like, now that they included a villain, it's just, he was really awful. Yeah. Like, really, I'm not blaming the actor, it's just really badly written. And it's even down to the point that they try way too hard to make him, like, to make audience hate him. Like, there was the one scene where they randomly spews out, I hate lasagna. And, like, there's no point. Because, like, it's just to say that, oh, Garfield likes lasagna, and he hates lasagna, so we must hate him.
Aye.
Yeah. The thing is, that character actually started off with a reasonable motivation. He was the only character in the movie who had motivation. Mm-hmm. And it's a completely sympathetic motivation, too. It's, I want to get out of the local TV scene and onto the national circuit. That's a great goal to have.
Uh-huh.
And then he goes a little bit off the deep end once he decides to start tasing Odie with a shock collar, but...
What on earth?
Yeah.
That's more
Yeah, exactly. This guy decides that his ticket to national fame, keep in mind, this was before YouTube was a thing, was he was going to find an amazing show dog and take the show dog on the national tour and become famous off a show dog. And so then he decides, in order to condition Odie to repeatedly do his tricks, he was going to train Odie using a shock collar.
Yeah.
No animals.
Because
all of a
sudden they
remembered,
Yeah, well, because also they realize, oh, right, this guy's supposed to be our villain, but he hasn't done anything villainous. So we're suddenly going to make him jump up and do that. No warning whatsoever. Like, he went from nobody to villain like that. Okay. It was amazing. And Matt,
yeah.
I'm stealing your movie. I apologize.
No,
it's fine.
That's the whole point of this podcast.
This is the whole
actually.
Point of this.
Yeah, okay.
No, but, and also, I need to add something, considering that this needs to be brought up, is mostly the fact of how Bill Murray is voiced by Garfield. And a lot of people say that it's very coincidental how, Bill Murray is the voice of Garfield, but Lorenzo Music is also the voice of Garfield, and he's the voice of,
You just said Bill Murray was voiced by Garfield.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
You said Bill
Garfield
Murray
was voiced by Bill Murray.
Garfield
was voiced by Bill Murray.
Oh,
No, that's not what you said.
Oh,
you didn't say Garfield was voiced by Bill Murray.
Oh,
you said Bill Murray was voiced by
Garfield. Classic Matt moment.
You guys gotta admit, that would be awesome.
That would have been.
Just think of...
No, but anyways, so
yes.
Garfield was voiced by Bill Murray, which Lorenzo Music was also, Lorenzo Music also voiced Garfield, but he also voiced, crap. Who was that guy in Ghostbusters
Dr. Peter
again?
Venkman in Ghostbusters.
Venkman, yeah. Lorenzo Music also voiced Venkman in the real Ghostbusters, which Bill Murray played in the real movie. So, like, they think it's that big circle. But in actuality, it's mostly the case of how Bill Murray thought the director was actually one of the Coen brothers. Which now, like, honestly, I feel that's pretty hard to believe because...
The writer...
What?
The writer was one of the Coen brothers. That's what he thought.
Yeah, one of the writers.
That's what he thought. But the thing is Joel Coen. He saw Joel Coen, and he thought, oh, it's written by the Coen brothers. Kind of weird that the Coen brothers are doing a Garfield movie, but whatever. They're good. Problem. Joel Coen of the Coen brothers is spelled C-O-E-N. This Joel Coen was spelled C-O-H-E-N. And that Joel Coen had done things like Daddy Daycare. No, not Daddy Daycare. He did the sequel to Daddy Daycare, Day Camp.
Oh, gosh.
There's a sequel to that? Oh, God.
And by the time he realized it, his name was already on the contract.
Oh, God.
So he actually recorded his lines while he was filming another movie on a boat. Bill Murray was on a boat, on a mother trucking boat, recording the lines for the Garfield movie.
And
explains the performance.
Oh, and no, it gets better. Matt, do you know some of the, like, contractual things and the things he had to work around?
I think, but it's not clear to me. Elaborate?
Okay, what happened was Bill Murray got lines, and he said, okay, these lines are awful, can I ad-lib some of them? And the people said, sure, but to a certain extent, because the live-action actors have already been filmed, and you have to work around their performances and their times. And their timing and everything that's already set in stone. We can't go refilm that, so we have to work around what's already set in place. So he was just hamstrung. Just absolutely just crippled in what he could do.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel at the same time incredibly sorry for Bill Murray, but I have such amazing respect for him. Because people say that it's a bad performance, but it's honestly the best performance of the movie. And I hate the character of Garfield.
Yeah, but I just need to ask one big question. Like, even if that were the case, what the fridge would the Coen brothers be doing writing a movie of Garfield? That seems completely out of their league. So I don't know what Bill Murray was thinking.
I don't think he was thinking, because he just... Maybe he wanted to sign the contract before someone else grabbed it.
Actually,
they did True Grit, 2010 True Grit. Did they do No Country for Old Men, I think? Was that them?
Yeah, they did. That was them.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah.
Also, the...
Dude, take a look at just those two movies. Oh, right.
Blood Simple, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou?
Aren't they Fargo also?
Yes, Fargo. Mm-hmm. Burn After
Yeah, so you
reading.
Just take a look at those movies right there, and you say, okay, the guys who made all those movies decided not to produce or direct, they just decided to only write the Garfield movie.
Well,
yeah.
Like, speaking of how Bill Murray wasn't really on his mind, where was his mind when he also signed into A Tale of Two Kitties?
That's an interesting case, because the Coens were in touch with that, so what was his mind during that process? It's like, oh, I did this movie, might as well just do the sequel for money. It could be.
I think the sequel was part of the deal. My guess is that the sequel was part of the deal.
That makes sense, actually.
I don't know
it was in the contract.
But he did a 2014 AMA on Reddit.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Because that was one of the stipulations, is he said, if we do a sequel, if you guys make a sequel, because it's in my contract or whatever, I have to be given more advance notice so I can write these lines better in advance. They didn't. They did it. They still filmed the live action actors first and gave his performances second.
Oh my god.
And
that's why there hasn't been a live action Garfield movie since.
Well, good, because now we have... Well, I have to say this. Everything that they've done since then, even with Garfield Gets Real, Garfield's Fun Fest, and Garfield's Pet Force, those took their liberties with the Garfield universe, but they didn't feel completely inane and outside of the realm of the spirit of Garfield. These movies did. Am I coming across there?
No, I can hear you. I'm just
coming to me.
I'm not gonna have an opinion on this, because those of you who watch my show know I'm not a big fan of Garfield, and I'm being polite here for whatever reason. So I'm just gonna let that statement slide and not touch it.
Okay. That's sort of why I brought you on, because I knew for a fact you didn't like Garfield, and I knew Matt's gonna pick it. I was like, oh god, it's gonna be a fun fest.
Yeah.
Hey, fun fact though, fun little behind the scenes fact, because I did the Garfield movie review. I did it in two parts. And here's the thing: I know for a fact that Jim Davis has at least seen part one.
Oh.
And I actually invited him, because I know someone who works in a studio, and I said, look, I know Jim Davis is probably a very busy man, and that he might not want to talk to someone who's slagging on his stuff all the time. Would you like to ask him to appear in part two for me? Just a quick little cameo. Here's the script. It's very gracious. It's very kind. He's got a sense of humor. He has to if you get that big. He declined for whatever reason or another. No time, whatever, but still. I know it for a fact that he's at least seen part one.
Damn.
Oh, joy.
Fair enough.
Yeah, that's good.
So,
that's really good.
Who's this new guy on the podcast? He talks about himself a lot and he brags. I don't like him at all.
Join. Oh, you mean that guy who's exactly like everyone else here?
Here's my experience with when it comes to the Garfield movies. We didn't even cover all of the characters there. I believe Arlene is also in the film, but...
Was she?
She was.
Oh, yeah, she is. She is.
She is not called by name.
Mm-hmm.
She is not called by name, and she just sort of appears as this black female cat character that happens to know Normal. No relationship whatsoever with Garfield.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that was watching it, I remember the first time, and I'm pretty much a Garfield fanatic as you, Matt. But this was in a period of my life where I was just sort of, I was still recovering from the Scooby-Doo movie, and how bad that was. And so them coming around with this, this was just an insult. I mean, my high school crush on Jennifer Love Hewitt flew out the window here because she completely butchered the character of Liz.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
And
down to the point, she's just a love interest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This was 2 years before Jim Davis thought that was a good idea for the comics. So
that's right. They got together. They got together in the movie before they got together in the comic strip. You're right.
Mm-hmm. Jim Davis.
The movie
was
came
like,
out in 2006. Yeah.
Jim was like, "Okay, you know what? This is the one good idea I think they made up with the movie. Let's roll with it." The second film comes out, and I'm working the same job that I've mentioned before on this show, the job where I was a caregiver for the handicapped fellow. I'm hanging out in his room one day, and an ad for A Tale of Two Kitties comes on the TV.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at that and just grumbling and said, "How dare they do that to Garfield? How this is such a butchering, yada yada yada." And the guy was like, "I like Garfield. Don't you say anything about Garfield." I'm like, "That's not Garfield.
Wow.
That's not Garfield."
Wow.
It's okay, James. He didn't know. He didn't know the words.
Yeah, no clue.
You know, that I find that really interesting, because this is maybe like an age gap thing in comics, where kids these days, and I'm getting...
Excuse you.
They don't really read comic strips as much anymore. They'll know the big names. Mm-hmm. Snapple, I can't hear you over there. But a lot of today's younger comic reading audience, the majority of them, not you, you're awesome, they don't know comics. They might know Snoopy, they might know Garfield, they might recognize Charlie Brown, and even some of the really younger kids today don't even recognize Calvin and Hobbes. They don't recognize this guy here, which is stunning to me. So other more obscure characters like...
Christopher.
Yeah, I think I just...
Like Hagar the Horrible, or like...
Oh, nope.
Are you kidding me?
Beetle Bailey? Nope.
Anybody my age doesn't know who Charlie Brown is.
You know, they'll know him, but they won't necessarily know him because they read the comics. They might recognize him through the holiday specials. Everybody knows Merry Christmas, Charlie Brown. Don't care who you are, they
won't
know.
No, I know.
Well, they'll know him now because of the new movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Recognize...
Calvin. Yeah.
Blasphemy.
But at the same time, you are an amateur cartoonist,
no,
an amateur artist. Okay. Well, I'm happy to be proven wrong in that regard, by all means. And Homicidal Psycho Jungle Cat, James, good man.
I'm sorry. It's like the
It's a magical world, absolutely. There's treasure everywhere. The days are just packed. I can play Name That Tune all day, James. I know these books. Something Under the Bed is Drooling. Weirdos from Another Planet. I'll take Calvin and Hobbes collections for 6,000, Alex. That's... You have that backwards. That's Yukon Ho.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you son of a... You son of a gun. Why did you have that in there? Why did you fix that in there?
Oh, God.
I can't see.
Okay. Scientific progress goes blink. and the Revenge of the Babysat.
Come at me, bro.
You have, I think you basically have all of them, don't you? You don't
except
have the actual
the first one.
Oh, the actual Calvin and Hobbes book. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
As long as the show, you know, I would go over and grab my whole collection, but that's an entire shelf and a half of my bookcase here. So, yeah.
So let's get this contract. Let's get this comic book conversation back on.
Comic strip.
Comic strip. Okay.
So okay.
There's a difference. I'm sorry, you guys are like still 12.
Me jelly.
The whole complete thing, all 10 years in one like 25-pound collection. I could kill a man. I could kill a man with this. Okay.
Hey, kids,
this book. Drew is going to eat or drink a snack or something and just take that entire thing and just spend an entire day just reading it all.
I probably have most of them memorized. If you give me the first panel of a comic, I could probably tell you the rest of it.
Sweet Jesus.
Thanks.
So, with me, with the Garfield movie and Tales
Penny
of
for your thoughts.
Penny for your thoughts.
Whose thoughts?
You said you could, if I gave you the first panel, you could complete the rest of it.
Oh. Penny for your thoughts. That's a Sunday strip. That's a long one.
Give me the next line.
Okay, Hobbs goes, sorry, my thoughts are worth a quarter, Calvin says. A quarter? I wouldn't even pay a nickel for your measly stinking thoughts.
It's Hobbs a says, buck a piece.
Oh, for Pete's sake. But the joke, the punchline, though, is, Calvin goes, fine, here's a quarter. Now, what's your stupid thought? And Hobbs says, a fool and his money are soon parted, and the last panel is the two of them fighting each other.
Yes.
And there. Ha.
There you go.
Okay. Anyways, I was going to say that my experience with the two films.
Gotta hang out more often, man.
You're a wonderful dork.
Why haven't we met you yet?
Yeah, why haven't we talked to you sooner, man? For me, I had the Garfield movie on VHS before DVDs came out. It was like an orange cassette, I remember. It was like in a clamshell, I remember, as a kid. Well, no, I was actually 14 mm-hmm. when they came out, so I used to watch it all the time. It was a guilty pleasure for me, to be honest. And I know it's gonna sicken you guys. It's like, that's a guilty pleasure for me. Like, the second film for me was horrendous. The second film's horrendous. I like the first film, but in a guilty pleasure kind of way. Like, the second film even had the guts to have Tim Curry as Prince, the cat.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, they wrote Tim Curry into this. Oh my god. Just
Tim Curry's in that?
Yeah, he was the Prince.
Whoa.
Yeah, he was the cat that he switches around with Garfield, named Prince.
Look, man, I just saw the first movie a year ago. I still am in recovery time here, so I'm not going to see Tale of Two Kitties
recovery.
Yet.
I mean, of course, the Tale of Two Kitties is basically, you know, the Prince and the Pauper, if I'm saying that correctly.
Yeah.
So it's just the old switcheroo between the two cats. Oh, the lazy, good-for-nothing cat gets to rule a castle in England, and then the royalty cat gets to spend laziness with his owner on vacation.
Yay.
It was stupid, but the first one for me was a guilty pleasure. I remember, like, the acting was good for most part. I mean, Bill Murray was just... Bill Murray's, like, the best part of it, actually, and everything else is just... Otherwise,
Bill Murray is the best part of that movie.
Pretty much.
Yeah, I just thought of something. If Bill Murray was played by Garfield, would that explain Saint Vincent?
Saint St. Vincent.
Go on. Go on.
Go on.
Continue that thought, James.
You've never seen the movie St. Vincent? Okay, go see St. Vincent. You'll see what I mean. You'll see what I mean.
Okay, so are we done talking about Garfield?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, good, because I'm next. I picked my own name out of the hat, so I'm going to up one Garfield, because before Garfield, there was Heathcliff.
There was a Heathcliff movie.
Yes, I'm going to talk about that, but let me... Heathcliff... Oh my god, I love Heathcliff even more than Garfield now. I even showed you my books. I have a stack of Garfield books here, but recently I've discovered Heathcliff.
Really?
And oh my... Yeah, like, I was reading the original stuff, you know, because Heathcliff was like a one-panel strip, or...
It's, yeah, a panel comic. It's a panel comic, yeah, is the term for it.
Thank you. Thank you. So I used to read everything. Because he's the...
It's my name! It's literally my name!
What's your name? But your name was John.
Literally. I am the comic strip critic. Say my name.
Oh,
say
okay,
my name.
Okay, go on.
Okay, comic strip. Anyway...
Now like, this is starting to sound weird.
Say my name!
The comic strip credit!
Oh my god. The fourth high hat and Heisenberg glasses all of a sudden now.
You wanna hit a child, what do you...
What is going on? Oh my god, I get so flushed and distracted easily. Anyways... I used to read
Mike,
the,
you were talking about the Heathcliff movie.
Let me... Yes, I was
Shut
referring
up.
To Heath... I was referring to Heathcliff, and... Whoa. And he was like the... I don't know if it's coming off... I don't know if Garfield's like a direct... I don't think it's not a direct, but he kind of is like Heathcliff in a way, because they're both orange cats, and they're just... I mean, Heathcliff's a little bit more than lazy. He's more mischievous. He's more like a normal cat, actually. Like, he gets into shenanigans and with his adventures in the panels. And he was in a bunch of TV series. There was one called Heathcliff and Dingbat, I believe. And then he had one with Marmaduke. And then in 1984, there was Heathcliff and the Cadillac Cats, which has a very catchy theme song. Like, yes. If you look that up, my god, it's, I listen to that shit all the time.
That
is a good theme song.
I haven't heard that in a couple of years. I haven't heard that since I did my video about it, and I still remember it. It's a good, god. The actual song is a good classic, catchy, upbeat 80s cartoon theme. It's actually a good theme.
80s! Thank you. Yeah, so I was, and it's on YouTube. You can watch all the Heathcliff cartoons from that show, and I was watching them for this podcast, actually. And oh my god, it's glorious. But of course, it was by Deke Animation, so they end up making a movie called Heathcliff the Movie, and oh no, guess what they did for the movie?
Mm-hmm.
They made it suck?
It looks like a compilation.
Yes, it was a freaking clip show.
Oh, what a cop-out.
It was a clip show of the TV show, and they released it in theaters.
In the theaters
in 1986. It was released in theaters.
That is low.
And it was like probably the last Deke film they released in theaters before they did the Strawberry Shortcake film in recent years.
So what you're telling me is that the one Digimon movie had a predecessor in format.
Oh my god.
Oh my god. I was watching and I was like, what? Wait, that's a Heathcliff. What are you doing? This is not a movie. It's a clip show. You should have done that in the show, not the...
How did it do the box office, whoa, if that was the case? Like, it was suddenly, falling off.
Suddenly, Top Cat and the Beverly Hills Cats is an all-around classic.
What? Look,
yeah.
This makes...
Hold up. I'm just looking at this quick fact on here on the YouTube page. Mike, do you know who voiced Heathcliff?
Yes, I was going to get to that. It's the famed voice actor Mel Blanc.
Whoa.
Yes, and that's why I like Heathcliff, because he's voiced by the famous Mel Blanc.
Wow.
And it was one of his last roles before he died.
Mm.
Yeah, which is... But it was good. He did a good job voicing Heathcliff. Yeah. It was like he did the Cadillac Cats and Heathcliff. Like, it was 1984 to 1988.
Mm-hmm.
And then his other stuff was like Flintstones related stuff.
Flintstones and Jetsons
died,
stuff.
But...
Yeah.
His last official role was in Jetsons the movie, where he had to play Mr. Spacely.
There was a celebration kind of special that he did as Barney Rubble. That was the last one he did. I just looked it up before the podcast, so I knew
okay.
What it was.
Yeah.
But Mel Blanc, my guy, Mel Blanc was perfect as Heathcliff. He was just like this sarcastic, like little sucker on the show. Like, oh my god. I was watching the show and I was like, that's a really good show. But there's no correlation for a movie, so I was like, crap, I can't talk about that on the podcast because it's just basically a clip show. So
that sucks. There's a Godfather parody in there. I'm looking at the Wikipedia page. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. It's a good... Seriously, if you have a chance, check out Heathcliff and the Cadillac Cats. It's really good. And the thing is about that show is, like, the Cadillac Cats, you're probably like, who's the Cadillac Cats? They splice in this secondary cast of characters where it's just a group of cats, you know, doing their own thing and not even... coinciding with Heathcliff. It was weird, but it's a really good show otherwise.
There's one character here who's a little the girl cat. She's a little
Yes.
Oh my
yes.
God, there's a girl cat.
Yes. Yes, there's a girl cat and she's wearing like leg warmers and
heck?
She's all she is
here. I'm gonna paste a Google image into the chat here.
Okay.
Thank you, yes.
Everyone take
yes.
a look at this and tell me what you think. Does anybody remember Lola Bunny from Space Jam?
This is even beyond
that.
Hold
on.
Because the flock of sheep? I've been reading comments on YouTube.
What
and
is that?
There are people who love this chick. There's furries out there who love this girl.
Oh,
I
yes.
Was like, I can't view because she's like, ha. Ah.
She's
yes.
like...
Three-quarters
like,
of our audience just went furry right there.
What is up with her forehead? It's like she's from Kodlioka or something.
She's got the big hair, she's got the leg warmers, and she's mostly naked.
Oh my.
She's like a more perverted version of that secretary girl from SWAT Cats.
Oh, it's like... I was surprised, like... And every time they show that segment of the Cadillac Cats, I'm looking at her the most... At the time, was like, damn.
Oh, I
know.
Mike, are you a furry now?
I'm not
gonna be a wolf.
I'm not saying anything.
Gonna be a wolf furry?
Shut
I
up.
Can imagine in your head. You can only like. I can imagine inside your head, like, you got Tom Jones inside, just singing, "What's new, Pussycat? What's new, Pussycat?"
In my head, I see. It going down in my head. I see you turning. Okay. No fans of Jason Derulo?
No.
Pussycat, I love you.
Yeah, we have been. We are having major technical difficulties right now.
Oh, does that mean we have to move off more? Sweet.
Yes, we will make fun of Mike's hidden crush on a cat girl. Wearing just only leggings.
Are you kidding me? I've had worse. I've had way worse.
What do you mean you had it worse?
I call it the Holy Trinity. I'll tell you afterwards. It's a little embarrassing.
Yeah. So, and I was even deep in research for Heathcliff because I've read somewhere that they're supposedly making a live action CGI Heathcliff movie.
I saw the bit of news. It was mentioned on the side of on the IMDb page of one of the Heathcliff pages. Yeah, like I'm on Heathcliff the movie on IMDb, and there's like a news article on the side that says like Heathcliff animated movie in the works, and that was an article back in 2009.
2012.
Yeah. 2009. It's really old. It's really old, and I've seen a picture of the CGI rendering of Heathcliff, and it looks just like Garfield, more or less, from the movie. And I was like, they better not be making that. They better be canceled, because I don't want that from. Get that away from Heathcliff.
Yeah, I will actually say, going back to the Garfield movie real quick. I don't want to get back on it real long because we spent a ton of time on it. I know the CGI in Garfield. I actually think that the CGI Garfield in the 2004 movie was not bad.
No, the actual animation.
It wasn't bad. It wasn't great. I wasn't expecting like Gollum or anything level of CGI, but through the budget and what they needed, he wasn't bad.
Oh yeah, he wasn't.
What on earth?
Oh, I'm looking at this. I'm looking at this image you just sent out now of the secret thing. Is that claymation? Are you sure that's not claymation? Because that looks like claymation.
That does not look like claymation.
No. Not oh my god! What in the world? Where did you find that, Matt?
I just seen that image. Heathcliff movie, and this was the second image.
What?
That looks.
I have not seen that.
That looks like Mr. Bumpy from Bump in the Night.
Oh god!
Oh.
I just found a better picture.
Oh no.
Oh, God.
Better, he says. Better. And massive quotation marks.
Hold on.
Oh, my God. What are they doing to Heathcliff? What are they doing to Heathcliff?
He's dead. They're going to kill him.
My precious Heathcliff is dying.
There we go.
I thought he had more dignity than Garfield.
Are you sure it's a Heathcliff, Heathcliff
had an old time to put this kitty down.
Okay, I just found another one. It's like even worse. Like you get a better view of what Heathcliff looks like, and it's a total crap on a stick.
Yep.
Now see,
God.
You look for Heathcliff images in Heathcliff movie in Google Images. And you're gonna get one of two results, and these are actually safe for work results. Surprisingly, you're gonna get Heathcliff the cat, and you're gonna get Heathcliff from Wuthering Heights. I hated Wuthering Heights in high school. It was the only book in high school I actually hated reading. I would rather go and watch that movie than watch Heathcliff the Clip Show movie.
Yeah, it was weird because I was trying to watch it before the podcast, and it opens up with Heathcliff with three other orange cats, and I was wondering, are these his kids, his nephews, his nieces? I have not seen the full series. I don't know if they're referencing back to the show. Like I don't know what that is. And it's a rainy day. It's like, oh my god, I'm so bored. You say you're bored. No, I gotta cut the grass and do this and that. And then he starts opening this photo book and starts telling these stories. I'm like, it's a fucking clip show. It's a clip show. Oh my gosh.
Because for a second I thought it was gonna be some kind of weird porno, but.
No.
Nope.
Okay.
So I was like, I know. So I was like, okay, I can't really talk that much in full detail, but I will say that, like I said, Heathcliff was in a short-lived series with Marmaduke, and Marmaduke was made into a film 5 years ago.
Wait, you're saying that Heathcliff and Marmaduke had a crossover together?
Yeah, it looks like it.
Yep.
Way back in the day, the Heathcliff Marmaduke hour.
Heathcliff would have been a snack for Marmaduke, at best.
Oh, yeah.
Especially.
Yeah. If you look at the history of Heathcliff, it's very interesting. Like, the shows he's been... Like, I don't know who Dingbat was. That was the first one. But then the second one was with Marmaduke. And I was like, okay, I can dig that. And then, of course, in the 80s, it was the Cadillac Cats, so...
Yeah, looking at the picture, I gotta say... Marmaduke here, he's just, like, one step away from looking exactly like Scooby-Doo.
Right.
He's a great Dane.
And with that in mind, if you know that Marmaduke looked like Scooby-Doo, who does Heathcliff look like?
Garfield?
Next to Marmaduke? He looks a little bit like Scrappy-Doo. I can't help but get a little tiny Scooby and Scrappy.
Oh, yeah. That is so true.
Let me at him, Uncle Scoob.
I'll fight him off
with puppy power.
Oh, my God. But, yeah, so Marmaduke was also a one-panel comic strip, and he didn't talk. He did not talk. He was just a fun...
What? Mm-hmm. He didn't talk?
Nope. Marmaduke never talked.
Okay, comic Marmaduke did not talk. Comic Marmaduke
Yes, I know.
Talk.
I know. That's what I was referring to. Talk?
Like, what was the premise?
So it was just like, basic, like, day-to-day, like, having a dog situations, like, oh, here comes Marmaduke, oh, watch out for Marmaduke, oh, there's a dog catcher, watch out for Marmaduke kind of thing.
Marmaduke thinks he's a lap dog, oh no. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just like pet situations, pretty
That's
much.
That's really
and,
cute,
actually.
Yeah, you should look
Marmaduke,
up, yeah, if you want to check those out.
Marmaduke's not a bad comic. It's not a good comic, I'll
no.
say, but it's harmless.
It's made especially for owners of big dogs.
Dogs.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, and for my background, I used to grew up and raised Great Danes, so I kind of have a connection with Scooby-Doo and Marmaduke.
The puppy.
This is something to actually note about Marmaduke is Marmaduke's creator, Brad Anderson, just a couple months ago actually passed away. The original creator passed away.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, he passed away at the age of 92. So it's sad, but
which
it's
is
not,
good.
But it's the sort of thing where it's sad, and you know, you mourn his passing. At the same time, you're happy because he got to make a nationally syndicated comic that people around the globe loved for decades.
Oh, I see.
And Mike's holding up.
That movie, I remember seeing that on TV like once or twice. It kind of, I didn't really sit well with me, honestly. I was like, This goddamn movie.
I mean, Marmaduke. This is the weird thing about the movie. It's set up like a John Hughes movie.
I don't know who that is.
Oh, yeah.
16 Candles,
Mia,
the Breakfast Club.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah, so the guy who made those films, it's kind of got that feel to it. It's like a teenage kind of high school. Because, okay, Marmaduke is voiced by Owen Wilson.
Mm-hmm. Owen Wilson?
Oh, wow. Wow, I'm talking dog. Wow.
Yes, they actually got a star cast for this movie.
Yes.
Isn't George Lopez also in that?
Yes. He's the cat. He's the cat in the family.
Because
they have a cat in the family. I don't think that there was a cat in the...
It's a bad idea to have a dog and a cat at the same time.
Especially a Great Dane and a little kitty.
So, they live in Kansas, and Phil, the owner, has a job in California, so they moved to California.
Why is it always California that they moved to?
And suddenly, I don't think we're in Kansas anymore, Marmaduke.
Yeah.
Because that way they can have
I'm
Tupac on the soundtracks going, California love.
Oh, I see.
And the OC theme.
Uh-huh.
But, so the whole family's like, at first is like, I'm in California, I want to go back home. I miss home. I want to be in Kansas. And Marmaduke goes to his dog park, and he meets a lot of these dogs. There's a collie, border collie dog, voiced by Emma Stone.
Oh, that love interest, that one.
Yeah, the tomboy kind
really?
of character. Yep. I'm trying to. It's been a while since I've seen it. I'm trying to remember. I didn't watch this. I kind of had this memorized, sort of. There are two other dogs. One of them was voiced by. There's a dachshund hound. I can't remember who he's voiced. And there's like this Chinese crest dog voiced by Superbad from. McLovin from Superbad. Which is weird. So many casts. And then, like I said, it's a John Hughes high school movie where they're in this clique. You know, the dog park's like high school, you know. Marmaduke's part of the outcast. There's the jocks. There's the cheerleaders. There's the hippies. There's the. So it's like I'm watching a John Hughes movie all of a sudden. I'm like, when did I hop into high school now? It was weird. Like, if you could take all the dogs out and just write it as a typical high school movie, that would be, like, perfect. Like, it was written just like that.
Mm-hmm.
The main bad dog is voiced by Kiefer Sutherland, named Bosco.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Oh, it's a all-star cast. It's
that's so many names. That's a surprisingly out of place voice. Like Kiefer Sutherland, I love 24 for the most part, but like Kiefer Sutherland is not a person I would picture like doing an animated anything. Like
he's got that low, graspy, husky voice, which kind of fit the dog he was playing. He was playing this bigger black. And tan dog. I can't remember what the breed was, but it was a big, tough dog.
Like,
it wasn't
like a Rottweiler or a German Shepherd?
Yeah, it was something like that. He was like the main pack leader, per se. Like, he's the main jock, as you will, in the high school movie. Like, he's like, you can't sit here. This is our territory kind of thing. He's trying to be in part of the clique.
Speaking of high school movies, there's a cameo that you neglected to mention.
Ooh, all right, just refresh my memory, James.
Okay, in in the dog park, there is actually, when they're introducing the different cliques between the dogs, they pan over to the drama club dogs.
Oh, you're talking about is it John Nelson?
Nope.
Oh.
No, okay, never mind. What was it? Keep going.
I think I know who you're going to mention.
Okay. Chris Colfer. Famous, only famous for playing Kurt on Glee.
Oh, okay.
Now, the reason I bring this up is because I remember watching this saying, my God, the chances of this guy getting off of this show and succeeding in a film career are slim now.
Yep.
And he was one of the most talented people on that show.
Yeah. So like I said, Bosco is Kiefer Sutherland, and he has a girlfriend, a rough collie named by Jezebel, and she's played by Fergie from Black Eyed Peas. Bosco's two minions, Thunder and Lightning, are played by the Whalen brothers, Damon Wayans Jr. Whalen.
This is the most schizophrenic casting I think I've ever seen.
It is. Yeah. It is. This is outrageous.
Don't use that word as an adjective, please.
Okay.
My apologies. I'm sorry. It's just.
All right.
The dachshund is played by Steve Coogan. There's a mysterious dog named Chupadagra, who is played by Sam Elliott. It is the weirdest cast ever.
It's weird that they got all these names to be in this.
Uh-huh.
And
they're not.
Sorry,
they just don't click well.
That, but the whole premise of Marmaduke is he doesn't freaking effing talk ever.
No. Nope.
It should have been simplified.
Yeah.
It should have been like, there should be no talking. They turn it into a talking animal movie.
Well, you can't really have a movie where the main character never talks, can you?
Yeah, you can.
Well,
you can.
You could. You could involve Marmaduke as like their.
No, it's possible. It's not easy, but it's possible.
Yeah. Well, all right. Here's what I was thinking. Like,
Wally talks.
Yeah, he doesn't say words, but the tone.
Okay, well, nobody talks though.
Exactly.
See, and that's animated.
When I was thinking
like
of when I was thinking of Marmaduke, they could have done the way of like Marley and Me, where they show the antics of the dog throughout their life.
Yeah.
That would have been a perfect way to do Marmaduke, like because Marley and Me was.
And it dies in the end. Like, the end.
Where this time he doesn't die at the end.
Or actually, a better example could be something like the live-action 101 Dalmatians.
Not a great example, but doable. Where the people react to the dog. The dog does things that people react. You look at Marmaduke, and it's clearly not what they were going for. Like,
no.
I'm wondering how this got greenlit. Like, who? Like, I'm genuinely curious because of all the possible comic strip adaptations that you could do. Like Garfield, I get. Big name comic, big box office draw. Peanuts, obviously, I get. Even Flash Gordon, they're making another Flash Gordon movie, which I know someone else is talking about soon. Is that you, James? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, James. Yep, he'll talk about it.
I get that because you know there's still a pop culture recognizability in that, especially after Ted, Seth MacFarlane's with Ted.
Flash Gordon.
Kind of
got a little.
Yeah,
we'll get into that, but.
I apologize on behalf of the entire podcast for everyone's now ruptured eardrums.
You're right.
Apology accepted.
Yes.
But Marmaduke of all comics just seems like a very...
Sorry?
Go on.
I've been trying to say that, you know what, I have a theory here.
Okay.
Hollywood has an unwritten quota for annual talking animal films.
Yeah, I agree with that actually.
The Air Buddies franchise perfectly.
Oh my god, I know that the Air Bud franchise.
Oh.
Disney and
Wait, that's a perfect example. Did Air Bud talk in that movie? In the first one?
Not the original.
No, not in the original, but they eventually veered off that track and had their puppies talking, which that franchise just went way downhill. Like that, what?
Mike.
And do I need to mention?
Since I'm like kind of irrelevant now, can I like get a drink? Because I'm like so thirsty. I swear.
Oh, go ahead.
That's fine.
Okay.
Go ahead. Yeah. That's fine. You're welcome.
Yeah.
That just. Oh yeah, that's right. That franchise alone, because those talking animals is just like the first couple of Air Bud movies. They were perfect. Dog plays sports. Perfect. Oh, what do we do next? We take the puppies and make them talk, and have their own little ventures.
I suppose that makes sense because some studio executive somewhere said, "Well, kids love Marmaduke. Let's make a Marmaduke movie, but he's got to talk. We can't have a." An animal movie, but the animal doesn't talk.
Not to
I don't know why I made my
Stripes,
student...
the Charlotte's Web remake. Every babe imitation
studio babe. Executive. I don't know why I made the studio executive sound like Vincent Kennedy McMahon, but I did.
Because.
And I just only mention all the dog stuff. There's human elements to the Marmaduke movie because, like I said, they moved to California because Phil, the owner, had like this executive job at a marketing for dog food. He meets up with William H. Macy, who plays his boss, to help promote this dog food, and he tries to come up with the ideas to promote the dog food. And Marmaduke's kind of in the way of him thinking about this. Like, there's one point where he has his laptop out, and Marmaduke bumps it, goes in the pool, wah, wah, wah. But the end, this is the weirdest conclusion I ever heard. He has the idea to do a dog surfing contest for marketing the dog food.
Okay, sure, why not?
Because there are dog surfers out there. They have in real life, and they took inspiration by that. So they have... So Bosco, the main baddie in the film, is the lead surf dog, and he wins surfing contests, apparently. And Phil, the owner, has this bright idea, oh, let's have Marmaduke go surf. And he has to compete against Bosco.
Because he's the main character, that's why.
Exactly. It's like, ooh, he's got to do that. It's going to be like this competition between Bosco and Marmaduke to see who's going to win. And then towards the end, like, he gets, like, washed away through... No. There's a point where, there's a point at the end where Marmaduke falls in love with Emma Stone, tomboy dog, and they meet up in the street somewhere, and all of a sudden, the pavement on the ground by a construction site starts to break. She starts going into the sewers like she's, like, drifted away. Marmaduke goes in to save them. They get stuck together, and they try to get help. The family comes by. Oh, let's help Marmaduke. The owner goes in, dives in, gets Marmaduke, and oh, we're a big, happy family. He saves Marmaduke. It's just, like, this random conclusion of a film. It's like, all of a sudden, it turns into this distress kind of situation, like, oh, I fell in this big gap and hole.
Yeah, that was the one thing... In terms of the plot and in execution, even if you were outside of looking at this as being a Marmaduke film, that's like the one thing in the movie that would just be like, okay.
That seems notable. It's the one thing that seems actually like noteworthy about the movie is it's a Marmaduke movie.
Mm-hmm.
It has a big Great Dane, so it must be Marmaduke.
I was gonna say the ending came out of nowhere.
It did.
Mm-hmm.
Completely. And even though they had the whole surfing competition kind of thing in there too, and I was
a
like,
surfing competition?
Where the hell is
this? Whoa! What?
Oh, I'm sorry.
You stepped away for a drink and you missed the world.
Oh yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry, Mia. Let me just catch you up a bit. In the film, the owner, Phil, is working for a marketing company, and he came up with the idea to have a dog surfing contest to promote the dog food.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. That's
so
random, but okay.
So dog surfing. So you see dogs on surfboards surfing. So you have a Great Dane on a surfboard surfing. And he fumbles at first, and then you see this big air. He goes, and the air was like fancy, and he's like, and then now he's just like, oh, look at Marmaduke go! He's got the flips and flies all over the place. He's winning against Bosco.
It's so funny. Look at it, everyone. It's comedy. Comedy! It's comedy!
Yes.
it's all over the place. It shouldn't be even made, because Marmaduke never talked in the comics to begin with. Oh wow, I'm Owen Wilson. I talk like a dog now.
Can I say this much about this?
Go ahead.
I don't. As strange as it sounds, I don't actually hate this movie.
I kind of don't either. It's just I groan every time. Like, I lose a little bit about myself because I know the comics more, but actually, because like I said, it's a John Hughes movie, so I'm thinking, like, oh, I just imagine the dogs are not there, and I'm imagining this high school movie being made, like, so, because all the clicks and all the...
Mm-hmm.
I was like...
Yeah, that's kind of, in order to sit through the film, that's kind of how you have to look at it, you know, just pretend you're watching something else. And I guess the difference between this and the Garfield film is that one, I never really cared too much for Marmaduke to begin with, and two,
true,
I 2010, I was going through an interesting time. I just
I just lost two grandparents, and I was sort of gaining the philosophy that, you know what, I need to stop hating on movies. I love movies. So mm-hmm. even if a bad movie comes along, there's worse things in life. So I just gave Marmaduke
right.
a pass.
I understand that philosophy.
I grew up a lot there.
Yeah, philosophy that as long as it's not like, as long as you take the idea that it's not directly offensive.
Mm-hmm.
There's a difference between a bad but harmless movie and an offensive movie. A bad movie you can just kind of forget about and go, oh, it was a bad movie, nothing really lost.
Like, it's still a movie. It's still something that a lot of people worked really hard to produce, even though it's not that great.
True.
It's still a movie. So,
because they actually use, like, actual dogs in it. Like, they use less CGI, but there's certain moments where you can tell it's CGI. Like, for Marmaduke, they had twin dogs doing the role.
Wow.
I mean, you could, like, you know, you could even, like, kind of like it in the sense that, hey, let's laugh at it. It's so bad, it's good.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
And I think it is, actually. I'm not saying it, just at first I was like, oh, but it, as I keep watching it more and more, I was like, dang, this is so
it's
bad.
Fun.
It's good. Yeah.
As long as it has some kind of charm to it, even if it's
intentional
or not, then it does have some kind of value.
Exactly.
Because there's a couple of fart jokes in there Marmaduke farts. Marmaduke farts. And everybody goes, Marmaduke!
That's my least favorite form of humor. That's just not funny anymore. I'm sorry. This is 2015. Enough fart jokes.
That was fun.
Oh, no,
that,
ago,
I know,
though,
but...
Yeah. It was, that movie came
I'm
out in 2010.
I'm so stupid.
Yeah, it was outdated by that point also.
It was because the best thing of all is that Phil's marketing kind of story kind of taters off to the end, where the last end clip, oh my god, they made a commercial and they showed it on TV, and it's Marmaduke and all the dogs dancing to What I Like About You by the Romantics.
Oh my god.
And it's all CGI.
Oh, I'm going to cry.
This is
so.
Do they dance on their hind legs?
Yes, they get up and go.
Oh, good god!
It's Razzie material, folks.
It's Razzie material.
They view it as a commercial. So in the movie, they produced this commercial, and it was just
okay. You know what that reminds me of, your description. How many of you have seen Just hear me out. How many of you have seen Jack and Jill, that Adam Sandler movie?
I think my dad has, and he hates it.
Okay.
I have.
Okay. That I scene have. With Al Pacino at the end doing the donut thing.
Oh, Dunkachino?
Yeah, Dunkachino. And at the very end, it cuts away to him going, I don't ever want to see this again. I want every copy burned.
Yeah,
and Adam
okay.
says, well, Mr. Pacino, what if we... I said every copy. And you're just like, okay. Yes, sir, Mr. Pacino.
Okay.
That's what this reminds me of. Like you see the commercial, and it cuts to Marmaduke sitting there with his paws like this, going, "I want every copy of this burned. I want every copy of this buried so deep that they're never gonna be able to dig it up."
E.T.
I don't...
video game. Mm-hmm. Sorry, that's just a reminder me of.
Oh yeah.
Dump it in. Weird.
We just compared the Marmaduke movie to Jack and Jill and E.T. That's some very bizarre tangents to go off.
Oh,
God,
guys, don't.
How do you go from one side to another, seriously?
Oh, my God, guys, yeah. So if you're watching this at home, just watch it. Watch it for your own sake, just to see what you like about it. If you like it, you like it. If you don't, you don't. It's fine. It's up to you. We're just telling you what you think about it, what you think about it.
Basically, your recommendation is it's worth a rental if you're going to laugh at it.
If you want a good laugh. If you want to see how cheesily bad they turn Marmaduke into this movie. That's basically what it is.
Okay. There's worse ways
so
to
So we
spend
go
a
from Yes, especially a short little film like that.
Mm-hmm.
Going from Marmaduke, let's go to the savior of the universe.
Oh.
Let's
Oh, yeah, I did
I'm not. Nobody.
I'm gonna sit back.
Nobody
and
hears Freddie Mercury.
I have no idea what this is.
Okay.
You will learn.
Okay.
You will learn, Mia. You will learn.
Okay, Flash Gordon. Mind
like
you,
a stripper. Sorry, I shouldn't have said that. Go on.
Mind you, we will get the. I've never read the comics, but I do understand a little bit of the backstory behind this. It is an early 20th century, very early 20th century comic about a man who is plucked from this world in a spaceship whose main thing is that he's a football player, and he ends up on the far side of the galaxy battling against humanoid aliens who want to take over the universe, and they're going to go for planet Earth next.
Right, that's the okay. movie's take on it.
That's the movie's take.
The comic strip has Flash Gordon as like a polo player.
There we go.
Not a football
polo player.
He's a Yale,
okay.
He's a Yale student,
yeah.
Or graduate. He's either a Yale student or a graduate. He's a graduate and he's a polo player. Because keep in mind, this was back in I think the 30s, like the early 30s that the comic came out. So
yes.
Oh,
so polo was a gentleman's game.
And mm-hmm. So following that, there was a popular form of media at the time. Before we had a TV series, we had the serials.
Yes.
And this is where Flash Gordon came to shine in a series of weekly black and white serials you could go see in the movie theater. And some of them mm-hmm. are actually available for viewing right now online on Amazon.com if you have an Amazon Prime account. But for the love of God, I was not going to sit down and watch a 5-hour long movie for this. Unless
yeah.
it was Lord of the Rings. But
I feel you, man.
So as Jane was talking about this, and we had a discussion last night about this,
mm-hmm.
and last year I did pick up this like little collectible video book about Flash Gordon the serials. It's
Ooh.
A collection of It has Flash Gordon, Space Soldiers, Flash Gordon, Trip to Mars, and Flash Gordon, Conquers the Universe, and it's all on individual discs.
That's like 15 hours there.
Yeah, there's 13 episodes,
Jesus.
12 episodes, and 15 episodes.
Like,
and I was like, I'm not watching this for this podcast, but this is like the original black and white serials in my hands right now.
I don't even
that,
like...
Mm-hmm.
I don't
Go
know.
On,
okay.
Mia.
If you're comfortable
like,
saying this,
oh, for the love of God, you just talk.
No,
Mia,
that's the thing is,
say
I think
it,
I think you're not talking. There's a lag here in Skype, so Mia, all you.
Okay,
Go,
I was trying
go.
To say I just don't like black and white movies that much. That's
really?
All I was going to say. No, I don't. I've always been kind of uncomfortable with old movies. Like when Morgan shows me his stuff, it's like, that's nice and all, but. I really don't get this. And then when it's something new, like Mike showed me Kung Fury, I was like, yeah, I'm really into this because I'm more familiar with the style of something new.
Yes. But yeah, this is like back in the day where the black and white serials were just the thing. And they kind of still did that to like recent years. Like Doctor Who is like one of the big examples of serials
oh,
where they went from
God.
1963
yes.
to...
Yeah. Okay.
So from 1963 to 1989, they did serials with each individual episodes before they rebooted in 2005 with their own singular episodes. But this was a nice deal, like $10, I think.
Holy cow! Are you kidding me?
It was, yeah, it was
wow.
like.
Wow! I gotta
like
find
10,
this.
20. Yeah, it's a collectible to have, and of course I have the original 1980 film in a 4-pack with The Last Starfighter, Battlestar Galactica, and Dune. And the DVD has special features with featurettes, and they actually have the first episode of the serial on the DVD of the movie.
Mm-hmm. So,
it's a goodie if you're a Flash Gordon fan.
So let's talk a little bit about this
Anyways.
Movie, which I had the fortune of sitting down and
watching last night.
Yes.
The plot of the film involves planet Earth being attacked by a series of strange rays from a very odd Fu Manchu man at the far side of the galaxy, and a man, and our hero is a guy who goes out into space. With a reporter and a scientist, and in a flying metallic dildo for some internet sex appeal.
I gotta see this.
Wait.
That one was.
Wait. Oh shit. You guys, there might be a problem here.
What?
Why?
After that? No, go on. Come on.
Did you realize this now?
I was reading you the plot line to Flesh Gordon.
Oh, that's right. The porn servitor. Oh my god. Flesh Gordon, that's right. Oh. I totally forgot about that. Yes. Yes. Thank you, James. I totally forgot about that.
I was.
Oh my god.
Yes. There is a porno spoof that was made in the early 70s.
Yes. Flesh Gordon. Yes.
Let me get this straight. You said the early 70s?
Yes, hold on. Let me look it up on Wikipedia. Hey,
what I'm hearing is that the parody version came out before the actual movie.
Wait, hold on.
Is that
what
you're saying?
Yes. Yep. 1974.
Because
what?
Because the porno spoof was actually not meant to make fun of any movie, but the serials. It was to pay homage to the serials.
Yes. Yes, so you got Flesh Gordon that came out in 1974, but the sequel came out in 1989 called Flesh Gordon Meets the Cosmic Cheerleaders.
I didn't know there was a sequel.
And now you know.
What the fridge?
Yeah, so
okay.
If you didn't know that now.
Well, if I ever do a crossover with the cinema snob, now I know what I'm doing.
Yes, Flesh Gordon.
That or is the porn
so, yes. The premise of the porno spoof is that instead of a bad guy called Ming the Merciless, we have Emperor Wang the Perverted.
Oh my god!
whose mission
that's
is to blast...
Terrible.
Whose mission is to blast Earth with sex rays that cause people to go into uncontrollable lust with each other and have instant orgies out in the street.
Okay,
this
sounds like something a 12-year-old boy wrote, just saying.
Well, actually,
look at the type
of
movie we're talking about here.
Okay.
Well, you may have your answer there. In the first 5 minutes of the film, there's a paperboy that gets gang raped by a bunch of horny joiks, as he calls them.
What?
Oh no, it's the horny joiks!
Yes. But anyway, moving on.
Wait, is Flesh Gordon a gay porno, or... I just noticed something.
Moving on, the whole punchline at the end of the porno series is that the reason why Emperor Wang the Perverted is blasting Earth with sex rays is because he likes to have all these orgies in his own palace, and he just wants planet Earth to toss aside their conservative ways and enjoy sex.
Same.
It is without a doubt a laughably bad, terrible, terrible movie. But
to it,
moving on.
Okay, I can
say
only...
to its credit, it made back more than double its budget at the box office.
Dang. Which is not. Which we wish we could save for the 1984 Flash Gordon.
I don't think that's Coke under the seats.
Wait, it's 1980.
Yeah, You are correct, but the point is, yeah, the actual Flash Gordon movie, Flash with an A.
Yes, Flash. Flash Gordon.
$20 million budget made back $27.1 million at the box office.
Oh, so it wasn't a flop.
Kind of.
Well, it wasn't a bomb.
It only lost like a margin. Mm-hmm. Like once you take in the expense of like movie theaters and that sort of calculations, like you would say they lost like maybe 3, 4, 5, 6 million, maybe.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Now that's in its initial box office run. That's not counting all the cult status follow-ups that came with DVDs and VHSs and things of that nature.
Mm-hmm. So okay.
Yeah,
that's not taken into account.
When I
say $27.1 million made, I'm talking about movie ticket sales in 1980. That's what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Adjusted for inflation and put the math together. Yeah, this movie, the first time I saw it was actually when I was a kid. I remember watching some televised version that a neighbor had recorded on tape, and that's what I thought it was. I thought it was a TV movie.
TV movie.
Because, my goodness, it is just everything in terms of the design, the aesthetics. I guess they were trying. Yes, I actually know what that means. Thank you very much. We have a case where this is a film that was doing what Buckaroo Banzai wanted to do. Yes, whereas Buckaroo Banzai was very loosely sort of spoofing the idea of 1930s serials and all of their corniness. Flash Gordon is the 80s trying to be a 1930s comic serial. And my goodness, it just so adorably, cheesily delivers.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, you have the case of set. The sets for this are somewhere in between magnificent and magnificently cheap.
Yeah, like if you look at the film, it looks like the colors and the sets. It looks like, in the props they use, it's cheesy, but it looks beautiful to look at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a case of It's also a case of they got some pretty notable talent to be a part of this.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they weren't particularly known during the making of it or the release, but afterwards, certainly you look back on this and say there's some familiar faces here. Sam Jones, the guy that plays Flash, never really went on to become a successful actor, but I do think he does real estate on the side, so, or something like that.
Well, he did some bit parts on television for a while. He had his own TV series called The Highwayman, which is very obscure, like Mad Max meets Truckers. Mm-hmm. It was just, but yeah, Sam Jones wasn't a big thing until Ted came out.
Yeah. We'll get to that.
I'm pushing ahead, but yeah, I'm just saying.
We have Ming the Merciless, played by Max von Sydow.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. This is the reason why this movie couldn't be made today, because remember how people were offended over Star Wars: The Phantom Menace?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, well, God.
Misa Reverse.
I thought you were going to say Cloud Atlas. Go on.
Cloud Atlas is actually rather underrated in my opinion. But moving forward, well, you have to sit through it twice to get it actually. But moving forward, let's see, who else do you have here? You have T'Pol, an actor famous for playing the lead in Fiddler on the Roof. Right. Yes, he's usually more of a musical actor. He plays the crazy scientist who foretold the aliens wanting to attack. And you have a few others on the side. Brian Blessed, comic actor.
Yes. Yes.
Extremely boisterous personality. And presence.
Yes, he's the best part of the movie, to be honest.
If you want to see him dressed as a Greek fairy, this is the movie to see.
Yes.
What?
Oh, it's the best. Oh my god.
Have Timothy Dalton in his pre-Bond years.
Yeah.
That
was
cast.
Pretty cool too.
That is a cast.
That is.
Man.
It is a really good cast.
Oh, and it gets better. You did mention. Go on.
It gets better. Guess who did the title music? Queen.
Queen. This is the point where Queen was going to do like these big soundtracks. Like Flash Gordon was one of them, and then later on they did Highlander. Mm-hmm. Oh my god, that's when they got most notable was Queen. Oh my god, the theme song alone to the movie is iconic, and it's you know the lyrics to it instantly.
This is why every time anyone thinks of this movie, the first thing they say is Flash. Oh, hero,
save
you
the universe.
That'd be cool.
Oh my god, now it just clicked on me. It's like, I know that song, holy crap. Well, considering I am a huge Queen fan, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, here's a fact actually about Flash Gordon. Go on, you were starting to say something and Skype is messing with us again with the lag. You finish your thought. This is your movie,
Well, I was about to go into the cult status so we could slightly segue into Mike's deal there, but if you have some trivia about the actual film,
I do have some behind scenes stuff too.
Yeah.
But
kind of some
ahead,
more cultural significance in terms of major pop culture.
Okay.
Without Flash Gordon, okay.
I know where you're going.
Back in the '70s, there was a film producer who wanted to make a Flash Gordon movie, a film director. And he approached people who hold the rights to Flash Gordon. He said, hey, I want to make a Flash Gordon movie, like the full Monty. And they said, yeah, we don't know who you are, no. And so he said, okay, fine. I can't make a Flash Gordon movie, so I'll make a movie that's kind of like Flash Gordon. That guy was George Lucas. The movie he made instead of Flash Gordon was Star Wars.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was going to say that too, but thanks.
Mm-hmm.
That's like... Like all
yeah,
these
that's the
were
thing.
So
like,
excited for the Force Awakens, like they have, like, I am too. But like, you owe like a debt of gratitude to Flash Gordon for that. It's amazing to me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so could you?
And to be honest with you, I wasn't alive back in the '30s or '50s, so I can't really make a proper judgment here, but I'm sort of guessing Star Wars is bigger than Flash Gordon maybe ever was.
Probably.
I don't know, honestly, because the old adventure comics of the 30s and 40s, they were kind of the big, like, before TV, that's the thing, is like, what the big pop culture standard is. Like, I would argue that the most influential thing in pop culture right now, this is arguable, I would say it's music. The big celebrities
definitely.
In the world are musicians. Your Taylor Swifts, your Biebers, your Kanye's, your etcetera, etcetera, etcetera. Twitter broke when Zayn Malik broke, when Zayn Malik left One Direction. But back before the music stars, who have always been big throughout the years, it was movies, and before that, it was radio stars, and back before that, the big thing was comic strips. Slightly jumping ahead to my thing. People would like line up and talk on the water coolers about the comics that appeared. They would say, like, can you believe that, like, that Flash is in trouble? Okay, you see, like, what's going to happen to Flash? What's going to happen to Prince Valiant? What's going to happen to Mandrake the Magician, or Secret Agent X9. All these old classic adventure comics. If the name Buck Rogers sounds familiar to you at all, or Duck Dodgers in the 21st and a half century, things like that. That mm-hmm. was like the standard entertainment back in the day. And arguably the last big pop culture entertainment thing before electricity was commonplace. Now that I think about it. Like back in the day, like if you say to someone today that your profession is, I'm a professional cartoonist, people go like, oh, that's cute. So what do you actually do for money?
Yeah, that bothers me, honestly.
Back at fair thing. It's like when you say, oh, writer, and there's an unfair stigma attached to it. But back in the day, it was not uncommon for cartoonists just to own like brownstone mansions and have butlers. That was a common thing back in the day. Back in the days when like Flash Gordon and all that was big. So it's hard to understand.
Yeah, suddenly wishing I lived back in that day, honestly.
Yeah. I don't blame you. I would love to have been back in the day.
Let's do the time warp again.
Yeah. Back in the day, like comic strip cartoonists were the big pop stars of the day. They were the big celebrities. People would walk on the street and they'd go, holy cow, look, there's Alex Raymond. Alex Raymond is the guy who draws Flash Gordon.
I would have loved that.
Like they get into like the big fancy like dinners and all those things. And I've met cartoonists who like do the adventure comics these days and the award winners these days. I hate to say these things because it makes me sound like I'm bragging, but I had cocktails back in May. On the one side of me was one of the syndicate heads who like syndicates and manages all the comics. On the other side of me was a reporter for the Washington Post who stunned me when he said he was a fan of my show. And across from me was Gary Trudeau, who draws Doonesbury. Mm. And that's the thing is, most of the people around us had no clue who these people were. The hotel staff who's managing this event was like, oh yeah, Doonesbury, you do that thing. Back in the day, Doonesbury used to like be something that the president would keep his thumb on. By the way, a highlight of my was making Gary Trudeau laugh on his drink. But about the Respect Comics used to be that out of the way now, so Flash Gordon! Excellent movie. I'm sure some studio executive somewhere kicked himself when he saw what Star Wars was doing.
His name was Dino De Laurentiis.
Yeah, I was just going to say, because he was an Italian producer. He wanted to make it, and he had the rights to it. And like John said, George Lucas wanted to make it, but Dino had the rights to Flash Gordon. And he's like, oh, gosh darn it, I can't make my Flash Gordon movie, so I'll just create something different to make Star Wars. But that would have been amazing if George Lucas made a Flash Gordon movie.
Yeah.
Could you imagine if he didn't make Star Wars,
that Flash Gordon movie? Like, what if instead of Luke Skywalker being like the big pop culture icon, it was Flash Gordon instead?
Gordon.
Yeah.
Or here's the thing. What if he did create that movie and history said, you know what, this is garbage. And then it just sort of sunk back down. Again, we would have no Star Wars.
It's one of the true mysteries of life.
And something would have to come in and fill in that cultural void.
Something to think about once in a while.
It's had a slight resurgence recently, thanks to Seth MacFarlane. Only because, yes, the movie Ted, in which the film is heavily, heavily referred to as the lead character's greatest childhood hero.
Mm-hmm.
And what do you know, they got Sam Jones to be in the movie because he's not doing anything else.
Yep. They brought him back for the movie. And there's even like a flash. There's kind of like this daydream thing that Mark Wahlberg has, and it's Flash Gordon on that hover.
Yeah, on the
hover bike
craft, and he's just like holding. It was so. That was so good. But
they go to a party, they get wasted, and Sam Jones looks at a Chinese guy that walks in and they're
Yep, like, next door neighbor. Next door neighbor.
Ming. So
looks at him like,
Ming.
Ming.
I gotta tell you, that's the one thing about Seth MacFarlane. He always has a knack of taking something that's obscure and turn that into comedy.
Yes.
And I'm done.
Yeah, it's funny because I seen Flash Gordon before Ted, and when Ted came out, and I was watching in the theaters with a friend of mine, when I saw Sam Jones come on, I freaked out. I was like, Flash Gordon? I'm a true fanboy.
Yeah. You know, they actually are making another Flash Gordon movie now.
Mm-hmm. Are they now?
It's from what I heard, yeah.
It's like still in like very early pre-production paid.
Yeah. We'll
the rumor is that Matthew Vaughn is in talks to direct. Now again, rumor. Complete total rumor.
Yes, rumored. Yeah, that's the rumor I heard, yes. The famed Matthew Vaughn.
Mm-hmm. So, don't know how to feel about that yet. I mean, X-Men First Class I liked. Stardust was enjoyably campy.
And that's gonna be interesting because those are comic book movies, and this is a comic strip based idea.
So,
which is, I don't know. Anything could happen.
He's got a track record that at least ranges from okay to good. He doesn't really have a major black mark on his record, so take that for what you will.
Mm-hmm. Okay, moving forward.
Alright, let's talk about the most iconic comic strip, The Peanuts.
So basically,
let's talk about The Peanuts.
This is a very rare animated feature, which we have not seen in a while. It's very simple. It's very calming. Nothing too big ever happens. So basically, this is all about Charlie Brown. It's basically his life and mostly going through an entire school year. What basically happens is that there's this new girl that came into town, the little red-haired girl, and he kind of has a thing for her. So there are several things he wants to do to impress her, whether it be in a talent show, whether it be to go well in the dance, or stuff like to do well on the test. You know, just those simple things. While at the same time, Snoopy is on the side, he would go and type his story against the Red Baron. And overall, I would say that it's really, really good. Not necessarily great, but really good. At least one of the best adaptations that I've seen so far. It keeps the tone of the original, of the original comics and the original TV specials very well. The animation is such an amazing job of what they've done with, they did such a fantastic job to make the 3D animation look 2D. The only time that I do have a bit of criticism with it is just when they tried to mix in 3D elements as well, like the flying scenes with Snoopy and the Red Baron. And the characters, they're just absolutely lovable, and they're exactly like how they are in the comics. And the one thing I will note about the Peanuts movie is that for any major Peanuts fans, they need to see it at least twice, because I went with my mom, and she, to my surprise, she was a really big Peanuts fan. She noticed so many Peanuts reference in there, it's just crazy. And like, there are a few that I have noticed, like the great pumpkin and stuff like that. But she noticed like one by one, which one of those are, and she had an amazing time with it.
Oh, yeah.
That doesn't entirely surprise me, because the movie was written in part by Schultz's grandkids, by Charles Schultz's grandkids. Mm-hmm. So, that helped.
Well, it was the grandkid and the son.
Right.
That did both. It was the joint thing, yeah. But, yeah, it was with good writers, at least. Not some bloke from the street, like, I'm going to take this and modernize this.
Mm-hmm. Now, from what I heard, the real modernization thing was the inclusion of that one pop song by the All About that Bass Girl. Oh.
Megan Trainor.
That's probably not.
I mean, it was even to the point that I saw one review. They mentioned it that they kept it timeless to the point that they still use those old phones, like with the cord and stuff like that.
Old like the old rotary phones or whatever.
Yeah, pretty much. They would still use rotary phones.
It's timeless. Oh, yeah. It was in good hands.
Yeah, they had. I was so surprised at so many things. Like I'm sitting through the ads before the movie starts. One by one, we have all these animated kids movies being advertised, and so many of them look the same. And so many of them have bathroom jokes and whatnot and really cheap, really sort of cheap humor. Bless you, Matt.
Yeah, thanks.
And it's kind of amazing to sit down and watch this and say, my God, there are no bathroom jokes. There are no kids bringing out their cell phones. Snoopy does not put on a baseball cap, turn it around, and start dancing to crappy hip-hop music. This is just a good, old-fashioned, G-rated family movie.
And it's weird keep in mind, this is coming from freaking Blue Sky, the company that just won't freaking let go of Ice Age, and somehow they come up with this. It's amazing.
Yeah, like, I'm like genuinely surprised, honestly, by not by the tone of the film, but by how well it's being received. Because a lot of kids in these days are very, very like high energy. Very, they have a whole lot of like, what's the term I'm looking for?
Fast paced,
hyperactive.
Hyperactive is a good way to put it. Which is very antithetic to just the overall Peanuts tone, especially if you go back and look at the old animated specials, which are so low key and so mellow and so simplistic in their animation. Like the most like, even like an action sequence, like an action sequence, I say in massive quotes, like anytime Snoopy fights the Red Baron, it's just Snoopy sitting on the side of his doghouse, from the side still. Mm-hmm. With a moving plate in the background. There's Snoopy and the background moving behind him. And that's all the action sequence is. It's him sitting there and is looking around and shaking his arms and just going, ah! And that's the entire action sequence. That's great. I think the reason that they had to do it that way initially is because it was they did it on like a fraction of a shoestring budget. And then it became so iconic that you wouldn't dream of having them do anything else. I think that's how it went, anyways.
And I will say that for the animation, I am thrilled that they did it in that 2D style. Because honestly, if they did like any other feature film where they did like it in full 3D and they moved the camera so much, it would have looked like garbage. Because the character designs, they're too simplistic to make it like a fully fleshed out 3D thing. It's just, and like to have like characters with eyes and have pupils on it, it just wouldn't work. It would look disgusting. But luckily, they kept it to the point that they kept it flat, and it's just pure genius. It's innovative. Like honestly, I could think of so many animated features nowadays that would have highly benefit to like keep themselves in this 2.5D look.
Yeah, it's such a simplistic, heartwarming, charming feel. That there's a real sort of warmth to it. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to find the right way to say this. This is not the best comparison, but it has the sort of similar like feel and tone and pacing. It's almost like an old episode of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, where it's just very simple, very mellow, and very like just talking to its audience, not like exciting them or anything. It's just like, it feels like it's kind of talking to you just very casually. It's kind of the mood I get from Peanuts.
Yeah, this movie has that. Even though the Red Baron sequences are, that's a little bit more intense than your typical Peanuts bear right there. I'll give this movie that much. But the great thing about it is, you do not lose. There's nothing about those sequences that loses the the purpose of Snoopy's daydreams. I mean, it's maybe a little bit more engaging than usual, but let's face it, when you were a kid, sometimes you had a cardboard box and you wrote stuff on it and you'd gotten there and suddenly it was a time machine. Yes. So a dog, exchange that with a doghouse, and suddenly you can look around the world and guess what? You're flying over Paris. You're shooting down a biplane. You're saving the poodle, you know?
Mm-hmm. And I will admit,
even down to the angles, how everything is covered. Like, even in those sequences where they're moving around, look at Snoopy in the doghouse. It's still a flat perspective. It's still very flat. Whether it switches to the side or front or back, it keeps to the flat perspective that was personified by the comic strips, by the specials, by everything. They have gone to great detail to try and make this as genuine of a Peanuts experience down to that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I will say that, like, despite being, like, really a lot of things that it did so well, and especially sticking so much to the source material, I will admit that there are a few issues with it. Like, as a feature film, there are a bit of flaws, and especially when it comes to the writing. And what I've come to learn is that a lot of it does come from the comics. I will say that the story is a little bit predictable at times. Like, you know, like, sometimes you would know how the outcome would go. And I will admit that I know what you just said about the Snoopy thing, is that despite, like, even though it is a very entertaining portion of the movie, I don't see what it has to do with the rest of the film. Like, it doesn't really know how to connect well to Charlie Brown's situation and stuff like that. And also
that's kind of always been Snoopy's thing, though. Is Snoopy is always kind of lived in his own little world a little bit, and he'll occasionally like cross paths with everyone else, but it's not really his intention. Snoopy is master of his own little kingdom in his mind, so...
Yeah, like I understand that. Like, I understand that it's kind of tradition, but, like, it would have really helped if it somehow had, like, one connection, like to help out Charlie Brown or something like that. But there's also one character that, like, I don't know, they should have worked out a bit more, is the little red-haired girl. Because, like, I know that the character, like, she doesn't do much, but, like, in the comics and stuff like that, but, like, in here, she doesn't feel like a character. She just feels more like a plot device to keep the plot moving and to give motivation for Charlie Brown. She doesn't feel like a character herself. And
congratulations, you just covered why she exists in the comic. Go on.
Yeah, she doesn't, to the best of my knowledge, I could be wrong on this, but in the actual comics, the little red-haired girl never appears in the comic. She is an off-screen presence that I don't think even speaks. She exists solely as an object of desire for Charlie Brown, which was actually my big concern for the movie, is after 65 years, 50 years of comics plus 15 years of other legacy building and other things, and now they're finally introducing little red-haired girl. And that's such a massively, massively difficult task. And I don't see she's necessarily been hyped up, but at the same time, trying to finally, like, make this character tangible when she's existed as one of the most ethereal characters you can ever imagine. I don't see how you could do that task and have it not be problematic in some way or other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but, and I just want to mention that if you guys remember in the beginning of this podcast how I would get an entire list of problems and stuff, like people complaining at me, here we go, this is one. So basically, I'm now getting complaints from people saying that because, like, they're trying to defend the movie by saying that the flaws that I have mentioned are because of tradition, so that shouldn't be a flaw. So, the purpose of the little red-haired girl, it's like, oh, but they did it, it's like it's meant to be that way. And also, when I mentioned about the plot line for Snoopy, that it doesn't have a point to the main plot itself, they always say that their defense is by saying that, oh, it's a parallel to the troubles that Charlie Brown has right now. So, like, whatever.
Get that at all.
Yeah, but, like, it still doesn't answer the question. What does it have to do with the rest of the movie? They have not answered the question. But then again, YouTube commenters be YouTube commenters.
It's also a tricky thing, because there's a legitimate argument for both sides, where you say, well, if you respect the old tradition, the way Sparky would have done it, Sparky being Charles Schulz here, that's his nickname, or yeah, do you modernize it for a modern audience? It's a toss-up that you have to... I don't know how you balance that out.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, like, that's the thing, that if you're really going to stick to the original source material, you will have to bring in some of the problems at the same time. But, overall, I'm not saying that it's a bad movie. It's really, really good. Right. It just has its problems. That's the thing. So, I guess it's something that you have to take it as you will. I'm not going to say it's the best animated film of, like, the decade, or not even the best animated film of this year, but it definitely is something that's worth watching. It's definitely one of the better ones, at least.
It's a high-ranking comic book movie.
Mm-hmm.
One of those...
James, did you just put it in the same race of, like, the Avengers and
Avengers?
Anthony and like that?
Comic strip movie.
Okay.
Yeah, well, it doesn't have a whole lot of competition, James, there, James.
James, you're getting those two confused. Comic book, comic strip. I mean, this is the whole reason why we're doing this episode, because there's a big difference between the two. And
like, Kara! It's the Peanuts Mafia comic
movie!
Yeah. Actually, I still want to cross over with him at some point, because there is, technically speaking, a Flash Gordon comic book, and there's a Spider-Man comic strip. And the Spider-Man comic strip is so wonderfully, horribly bad.
Yes.
That's neither here nor there, though. It's so stupid.
In one or a few of his videos, so could be possible.
I've been in one of them. Yes.
Yeah, you can't. I remember that. Yeah, that was cool. The Peanuts was a big thing for me growing up. So all of us, I would think, because it's iconic enough. You know, we remember watching the specials. You know, the Christmas, the Halloween, the Thanksgiving specials. It's very iconic. I remember loving Snoopy to death. I loved. It's funny, we're talking about this now, because recently, a couple of months, maybe a month ago, James and I were watching a Peanuts special, or actually a Snoopy special, and it was, it's Flash Beagle.
Yes, the only part of the Peanuts lore that you won't see referenced in this film, Flash Beagle. They have everything else. The kite eating tree. The great pumpkin.
Great pumpkin. Dog germ. One that I recently discovered, the dog germs one.
Oh yeah, dog germs. The toaster.
Dance.
The dance. What have you? I walked into this movie with like a checklist of stuff, and I was just like, okay, Flash Beagle's the only thing that.
Yeah, he was doing that as we were watching it. I was just like,
mm-hmm.
Oh my god, because it's one of my favorite specials, because it's weird how they took inspiration from Flashdance, which, of course, Flash Beagle, Flashdance, and they rotoscoped the dancer from Flashdance for Snoopy's dance moves in the special, which was really cool. I remember watching, like, the behind the scenes of that. It was pretty cool. That Flash Beagle song was just so... so 80s. So, like... so catchy, too. It's Flash! Flash Beagle! I think there's a clip of it on YouTube. You can find it. It was the... where he goes into the club. Because at night, Snoopy dresses up as Flash Beagle. And you see him walk into the club, and he's getting all dressed up, and he's got this, like, the flash dance look, where it's all the headband, the sweater ripped, he's all ready to dance, and you see Franklin there, too. Franklin's there at the club with Snoopy, too, dancing.
Mm-hmm.
And there's other songs in there, too, besides Flash Beagle. It's one of those specials where it's... I don't know, it was a weird... because of The Peanuts sideline besides Snoopy was they're at a party and they do these weird dances, like Lucy says, you gotta do this, do that. There was a song about Lucy doing this and that. It was very weird.
Mm-hmm.
Such a long history, that franchise.
It is, and I loved every second of it.
If it wasn't already 120, there's a pair of very interesting articles that I talk about, which go really in depth into the industry and the role of the cartoonist now versus the world of cartoons back then, and how they interact with the world in terms of merchandising and putting their own personal philosophies out there. I might just save that for an episode of my show. In fact, you know what? I'm gonna put that on my to-do list right now. I'm sitting in front of my whiteboard here, and I got about, like, 25 episodes planned or something here. So, we'll put it on the list. Put it on the list.
It's editorial.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You're welcome.
Matt, did you, here's something I noticed that I'm hoping somebody else did, too, about the Peanuts mm-hmm. movie.
Yeah.
Did you recognize, the name on the moving truck?
Yeah, I heard about that. Yes. Yes,
explain
actually.
Explain for those who have not seen the film.
Mm-hmm. I know.
That's me,
okay,
too.
Yeah, I know.
So explain. Explain to...
Do you want me to say, or...
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, I remember... I know who they are, but I know one of the names. Bill... one of them is Teletita. Yeah, it's Teletita. Hold on, let me look this up. I know who it is. Well, they're pretty much the two main guys who have worked on the TV specials.
And the other name was Melendez.
Melendez, thank you.
Oh, Bill Melendez, mm-hmm. Snoopy's voice actor. Okay.
Yes.
Bill Melendez,
yeah.
And did I get the other one right? No.
Bill Melendez, Lee Mendelsohn.
Fudge, I was way off.
Melendez and Mendelsohn.
Tom,
maybe.
Vince Guaraldi, Tom Everhart, Clark Gesner.
I saw Melendez and Melendez.
Melendez is definitely in there.
Mm-hmm.
Melendez and Mendelsohn is my guess. Sounds like... Yeah.
I think the other one was Mendelsohn.
Okay, yeah, those are the two guys then. So yeah,
Melendez and
yeah.
Mendelsohn.
Yeah, Melendez has been Snoopy's voice actor for forever. Even, I know, in this movie, post-mortem, he's still Snoopy.
Yep, they use
archival.
Yeah, some archival points. I think there's a little bit of voice modulation.
That's another thing I want to mention. The voice actors, they are incredible.
Yes, yes, I wanted to say that. So they brought kids to do the voices.
No big names, no nothing. Just like
well,
they
the
used
only,
yeah,
the
they,
only big
they,
name is actually Kristen Chenoweth just doing the voice of Fifi, but that's it.
Well, if you're a younger generation out there, you might know a familiar name who plays the little red-headed girl. If you know your Disney shows, there's a young little starlet known as... Let me find her name, if I can...
Francesca Angelucci Capaldi.
Yes, she is very well known on the Disney Channel. She has been in Dog with a Blog. I know this is a ridiculous title, but the show's ended. And here's a little fun fact. She's the granddaughter of Peter Capaldi, the current Doctor on Doctor Who.
Oh, okay.
A lot of people... she's just... I watch a lot of Disney Channel, so I knew her from the start. So I was like, oh, yeah. She's in this film, playing Little Red-Headed Girl. That's cool. She's getting up in the world, but...
Yeah, she's only 11 years old. Wow. So, yeah.
Yeah, she was on the Disney...
Okay.
She was on the Disney Channel. That's the only name I knew. Everything else was just... Yeah, it's all these kids.
It was a little jarring, because... on Halloween, I saw the... You know, the special, the Great Pumpkin special, with the old classic child actors, and then they went immediately from that into a commercial break, where it has the kids. I think it's like a Target advertisement, where it's all the kids doing auditions. The kids are doing the auditions thing, and to hear the old voice actors back to back with the new ones. Like I said, I haven't seen the movie yet, so I can't pass judgment. I'm not saying it's bad, but it's just a little jarring to hear the one right next to the other, and I was just like, oh. Whoa. So it was a little weird. Also, I know we're kind of ragged on Seth MacFarlane tonight, but watching Brian and Stewie suddenly pop up there in that Target commercial did get a laugh out of me.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty
weird. That was funny.
Yeah, that was good.
It made me laugh. I am going to see the Peanuts movie on Monday, so...
Good.
I'll do, hopefully, at least a vlog then, because I know my poor followers are starving for content, especially since I missed last week's Punchline Weeklies, and I might miss it again this week, because, test on Monday, studying for it. So, yeah. Thank you for your patience, everyone. I love you. I have not forgotten you. I'm done with the self-advertisement for now. Carry on.
Okay.
Anything else about the Peanuts?
That'll be it. Well,
go watch it right now. Apparently it's better than Spectre, from what I've heard.
Oh, bless me.
James has seen both back to back.
Bless me,
no,
sir.
No, it's... Well, maybe now it's overtaken Spectre, but when it came out, it came second to Spectre. So.
I don't know. For a movie that's going up against James Bond, it's doing extremely well for itself. In fact, what the Peanuts movie is doing, like, in terms of animated features, it's not the best, but, like, it's still pretty well for itself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'd say so.
Yeah. Which is remarkable, because the core of the Peanuts franchise, the comic strip, died the day after Charles Schulz died. 15 years ago. There has not been a new Peanuts comic strip in 15 years. Everything after that has been all merchandising stuff. It's been MetLife commercials. It's been video game times. It's been, like, re-releases of the old comic strips. So for a franchise to be doing that well, that long after any new material has come out, is something to immensely respect. And granted, there's other franchises that do that. You know, there was no new Star Wars movies between, 83 and 99? And then again from 2005 till now? Or 2003 till now? Whatever it was. But still... That's something you have to immensely respect, especially for something that's as low-key as Peanuts. It's not all action and spaceships and lightsabers and blasters like Star Wars. Something that's as low-key as a kid, his dog, a bird, the doghouse, Linus's blanket. That really says something about just how much of an impact that Charles Schulz managed to make. Not just in the world of comic strips, but pop culture... in general, that's astonishing.
I have to say so.
Mm-hmm.
We are saving the last, and probably something that we don't know, but John knows a little bit more of.
As I am wont to do. I, of course, everyone else went for the big names. Everyone went for Charlie Brown.
Yes.
Went for Garfield. Everyone else went for Flash Gordon. And I was like, that's too obvious. Everyone knows that. I'm going to go back a little older. So I have both, I think, the oldest comic here that the movies are based on, and the oldest comic strip, too. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Prince Valiant, and this is actually a collection, a reprint from 1937 to 1938. Those of you who've seen the show know, honey, guess how many comics there are per page in this thing?
300.
No, per page.
10.
You sure?
Wait, let me double check.
One. There's one comic per page on this thing.
Oh, you meant like
that's
the
how
panel.
Big these comics.
Oh.
Yeah. No, not panel. I said like, in like, comic collections, they all have like 3 days per page, like all like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday on per page. This is what ran each week. I love this comic to death. The artwork is so amazing in this thing. But in 1954, there was a Prince Valiant movie which was released, starring a bunch of guys whose names I've actually never heard of before. James Mason.
Me neither.
Robert Wagner, who actually is probably the most noteworthy name that I still remember. Robert Wagner appeared a little bit in NCIS as Bilzo's father. He also appeared in 2 and a Half Men. And a couple other smaller bit roles more recently. And here's the thing. I don't know how many of you have seen old films in that movie. If you've ever seen like the old 1938 Adventures of Robin Hood with Errol Flynn, great movie. Go see it. And I was expecting something to be this to be kind of like that movie. I was very disappointed.
Aww.
Yes, I was. The colors were very drab. I couldn't stand the guy who played Prince Valiant because he came across as a very mean jerk. He was a stupid jerk face. And here's the thing. And here's the thing that really killed me in the movie is about the middle entire like two quarters of the movie is dedicated to one of the most asinine, stupid love quadrangles that I've seen in years. And it just killed the movie dead in its tracks for me. And so I was thinking to myself, okay, you know what? Hopefully here, the end fight's going to be awesome. Because there's a traitor in King Arthur's court. And at the very end, Prince Valiant finds out who it is. And they have this big fight. And I was expecting, you know, some awesome sword choreography and some epic music in the background to go along with it. The fight choreography goes like this. It goes ting, 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 for about 6 minutes. And the background music? There is none. It's silent. Just the sound of ting, 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 ting for about 6 solid minutes. And even the way the fight ended. Jeez. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And the way the fight ended, like, you're expecting some massive thing where Prince, like, the villain goes for, like, a dirty trick. He, like, reaches behind his back and he pulls out a second knife or something, and then Valiant, like, heroically knocks it away and slays his foe in a valorous fight. No. Prince Valiant falls on his back, and the villain falls onto his sword. I'm not joking. I kind of chose the movie here that had the least impact on pop culture, because that's kind of what I do. That's how I started my show, as I try to find something
that's what
no
Mike usually does, actually.
That's what I do too often.
Yeah, yeah. And is it worth going down and hunting out? Not this particular movie, I think. There's other movies in that same genre that you can go and see. Like I said, The Adventures of Robin Hood from 1938, starring Errol Flynn. Genuinely good movie, and it has a great one-liner in there, where Robin Hood is... the setup for Robin Hood, of course. King Richard is off fighting the Crusades and leaves his brother Prince John in charge of the throne. Robin Hood says... you're abusing the powers of the throne. And the Sheriff Nottingham says, you speak treason. And Robin Hood goes, yes, fluently. Good line. Good line. Yeah, so that's a movie that's worth seeing because fight choreography is way better. Errol Flynn is absolutely charming as Robin Hood. And I kind of had that as my standard to live up to watching Prince Valiant. Prince Valiant came in about here. So I was very disappointed. Yeah, so... Now, there was a supposedly... I wish I'd found this one instead, because I thought, oh, the Golden Age of Hollywood, that'll be fun. There was the Prince Valiant animated cartoon series that came out in 1991. I did see an episode of that on YouTube. It's actually better in some ways than this movie was. There was actually a little bit more drama to it than there was in this full-blown big-budget movie. And there was another movie that came out in 1997... And one of the people...
Well, it was made in 97. It was released in 2003. The soundtrack is based... Never mind.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Soundtrack.
Go ahead.
Yep. But one of the actors in this 1997 Prince Valiant movie was Ron Perlman.
Oh.
Kind of surprised me. And now I'm thinking to myself, of the three or four different adaptations I could have chosen to look at, it looks like I picked the worst of the bunch just by sheer random happenstance. I thought, oh, it's the golden age of sword and sandal and swashbuckling Hollywood films, all those good classic movies. The closest thing I can think of and feel to this is The Princess Bride. It has that same sort of old school golden age film, golden age of Hollywood sort of thing. So if you like The Princess Bride, as you should, check out The Adventures of Robin Hood, because you will like that. And that's the thing is, I chose the comic that nobody knows, and I chose the movie that nobody knows, so I get to carry this entire part of the conversation by myself now.
Well, let me ask you this. Is the comic Prince Valiant, because I've only seen the artwork, I've never actually read any Prince Valiant comics, is it something that you would say fits in the same category as Robin Hood on an Adventure Comics scale?
Absolutely.
Or is that what you... Or is that...
That's what I think.
Okay.
It's an Adventure Comic...
No, you go on. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Okay, how do I put this? If Robin Hood is a chaotic good outlaw hero, Prince Valiant is a neutral to lawful good agent of the law. Sort of hero. He fits very much in that same sort of vein, and I like him. And he's got a couple good Robin Hood moments here, including a moment where he was Batman before Batman was a thing.
Oh, yeah?
He takes a goose. He is just him, and he has to clear out an entire castle full of bad guys. So it's this brilliant moment, actually. I love it. He takes a goose, kills it, skins it, and fashions the goose skin into a demon's mask. He puts on the demon's mask, climbs up to the window on a rope, and then swings himself in on the rope into the main villain's guy, and he goes, ah, my master has seen your evil soul, and when I come back, I will take you to hell. And he swings back out, and the villain's terrified. And then 5 seconds later, Valiant swings back in and goes, and so I have returned. And the guy drops dead of a heart attack.
Whoa. Oh my god.
And so then he goes
That's
around...
That's kind of priceless,
everyone,
actually.
Yeah, no, it's great. So then all the villains, all the bandits or whatever, are having their big dinner in the main dining hall. And Valiant actually, blows out half the candles now and swings in on this rope, flying over them with, his cape fashion, like massive demon wings, wearing this mask. And I go to myself, Bruce Wayne must have been reading Prince Valiant as a kid, because that is exactly a Batman move. And so the bandits all run, they scatter, and they run up there to find their boss, and the boss looks like he's dropped dead from magic. From black demon magic, and so they all leave. And I was hoping to see something. I was hoping to see something that brilliant in the movie, because it's at least from this collection, from 37 or 38, that comic ran. I was hoping to see something that brilliant in this movie. No,
but I actually just realized something that I honestly really regret. It's just suddenly I realized that I could have chosen a movie that would have immediately beat yours in terms of age, like something that was much older in terms of its comic. Okay. I'm sure you could guess it.
There's the old 1937 Batman serials.
Well, No. The movie itself is a lot, it was made much later, but I mean the comic itself.
Okay.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about.
I have one of three guesses. Go on. I see. Think you if you say either the Cotton Jammer Kids or Gasoline Alley, I'm going to be very surprised. But you might also be leaning towards Dick Tracy.
Not even.
Okay.
I got a guess. I got a guess.
Okay, I think it's the same. What is it?
Okay. I was going to say Crazy Cat, but that that doesn't have a movie.
If you're thinking of things, come on. Say it.
Felix the Cat. The wonderful, wonderful cat.
Not even.
No, I think I know what he's talking about. Is it? I'm going to do it as a question mark. Is it the Phantom?
No. Oh my god.
Okay.
What?
Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
Wait. This is a real stumper now. What the heck is he talking about?
You're embarrassing me here, man.
Oh
boy. Do you still want to guess, or do you want to know the answer?
I don't know. Not Buck Rogers. Not Magic the Magician.
What is he?
I don't know.
I'm.
Just tell me.
Just
I'm surprised you guys forgot about Little Nemo in Slumberland by Rizzo.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my god.
That is so true.
Oh my god, I totally forgot about that. That was based on a strip.
Yeah.
Oh my
that was
god.
Yeah. And the artwork of that
god.
Was amazing. It was like a cross between Alice in Wonderland and the Wizard of Oz. It was beautiful.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh my god.
No, Wizard McGill
wow.
is really fantastic artist.
Oh
and
yeah.
It's amazing how disastrous the movie became. Like so many people tried and failed to work on the feature, but it's just it completely threw off.
I don't know, like there are certain things that in 2D images are really hard to capture in 3D motion. Like
mm-hmm.
like Dr. Seuss is an example. The Dr. Seuss movies, both CGI and live action, they come close but they don't quite nail the feel. Now interestingly enough, if you've ever been to the theme park Universal Islands of Adventure down in Orlando,
yes.
Florida.
Yes.
They have a Seuss like mini theme park there that is pitch perfect. It is exactly Seuss come to life.
Oh,
you
it
can
is.
Even like what's the name of the old dude in the Lorax who like tells the narrator?
Wensler.
Yes, the Wensler. His house is there in the theme park. You can listen to his little ear trumpet, and he's got the old craggly, wrinkly voice, and it's just perfect and wonderful. But point is like Little Nemo is just that sort of strip where it's so wonderfully bizarre that I don't think that it's possible but immensely hard. You would need a really talented art director to pull that off.
Mm-hmm.
Also, looking back at Little Nemo now, I actually unfollowed the comic for a little while on my subscription page because there was a storyline there where Little Nemo and his friend, who was like a ship captain or something, they went to this island and they met the native people. And this being the 1920s, the native people were a little blackface looking. Like the big massive lips
big
that
lips
were going like all around this.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like very kind of monkey looking. I'm just like, I'm gonna come back to this one in a couple months. I wouldn't. It's the sort of thing where I wouldn't want the original comics. Like, if the original comics were re-released, I wouldn't want them altered, because that's how they originally ran, and we shouldn't whitewash... I don't think we should whitewash history. Like the Song of the South, what Disney said. Disney put a notice in the front of Song of the South saying, these views are outdated, they're not our current views, but we don't choose to alter them, because...
When?
Like a couple years ago, maybe as little as a decade ago, Disney re-released the Song of the South, including all the unfortunate stereotypes.
When was
yeah,
that? I never heard of
I
that.
I swear to God they did it.
No.
He's going to look it up to prove it.
I'm the Disney guy here. Show me.
I thought they... Hey, look, you got me on Little Nemo. I am allowed to get you on this.
I'm going to tie this all back together, and I'm going to do something I used to do a long time ago in the podcast.
Please
but
do.
I'm
wrap
do
this up.
I'm going to wrap this up, so... Back in the day, I used to do a little end segment where I talk about the weirdest thing I've seen in the topic. And this relates to everything, basically. Prince Valiant appeared in an episode of this TV show. This is a show I should have watched. Came out in 1986, and it's Defenders of the Earth.
He-Man?
Defenders of the Earth, which had Flash Gordon, the Phantom, Mandrake the Magician going against Ming the Merciless.
Oh, and I need to see this.
This, I have to see it too, because here's the catch. Listen to this. It's set in the year 2015.
It's November, man. It's halfway through November. Why did you not tell me about this earlier?
I didn't know either until now, because once you mentioned Prince Valiant, I said, keep hearing this show. What's this show? And I just looked at it right now, and I'm like, okay, I'm done. I'm going to watch a show right now.
Oh my gosh, I'm looking at all these like things. Jeez.
Yes, 1986. Man.
Defenders one season, of the 65 episodes. Jeez, that's nothing to sneeze at.
It was short-lived, it lasted,
65 episodes is not short-lived. Avatar The Last Airbender ran for like 60 episodes, man.
Oh, okay. I don't know shows that much, I mean. Man, and I was thinking about this too. Like, I read about something like this before in the past, and I can't remember until now, but they should, if Marvel's doing the cinematic universe, like, comic strip people should do, like, something like this with Defenders of the Earth. Like, have a cinematic universe with Flash Gordon, the Phantom, Mandrake the Magician, something like that going on.
Garfield!
That's what I'm... Mm-hmm. Yeah. Screw the Garfield.
I wouldn't mind... Every once in a while, comic strips throw out little references to each other. Like, technically speaking, if we use Dick Tracy as our baseline, Dick Tracy and Batman take place in the same universe.
Mm. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm like, okay, that's kind of odd. But the villain was talking about his friend the Penguin over in that other city with that bat guy. And I'm like, I'm sorry, what did you say? And it looks like that thing. I've been looking here, but that thing about the Son of the South. Yeah, I can't. I'm sorry, it appears the way I was wrong. I must have fallen for a Tumblr hoax or something. But...
Well, like, the monster... Okay,
congratulations, Matt.
Well, in your defense, I would say that there was at one point that it aired on, like, one of those public services. Like, they would air on those public services things, so that could count. Because I remember seeing a version where, like, little ads would pop up and say, video not for sale and stuff, you know?
Yeah. I remember that. I had a friend of mine whose uncle was, like, an actual paid newspaper movie reviewer. And he would get, like, private VHS ahead of time that say, like, this version not for sale, do not copy, do not distribute, do not sell, to blah, 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 blah. So, yeah. So maybe I was thinking of that, but it was literally just, like, one image on, like, Tumblr or something that said, like, we do not alter the original movie.
Yeah.
The views are outdated and they do not reflect our current views, but we feel it's important to show the movie as it originally was for purposes
of authenticity. You know what you're thinking? I know what you're thinking of, actually. It's not Song of the South. That was actually for Speedy Gonzales.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I know Warner
But I thought, okay, so I just got my... Okay, anyways.
We all learned something new tonight.
We all did.
Yes.
All sorts of good things. This was fun.
This is a longer episode, so if you stayed along and... through this whole darn thing, I give you props for that. Thanks for listening and watching this episode of Cinema Royale. I give major props for John here for going through all this with us. It's an honor to have you on with us.
No, this was a blast. Are you kidding me? It's actually really refreshing, and I really do like hearing so many people talking about the comics themselves. Because that's always a fight with this industry in comics. Because like I said, I've talked to cartoonists, I've talked to syndicate heads, and that's the big fear right now is newspapers are dying, so they're finding other ways to sell their product. Which I will say that there is an app which is free, and you can make your own comics page on it. I'm not paid to say this; they don't sponsor me or anything. But yeah. If you, I think I just killed Mike. Are you okay, Mike?
More sponsorships. More sponsorships for this episode.
I'm not.
Check out this channel. Check out Go Comics.
Yeah, but that's my thing right now is in my own tiny little way, I try to help out cartoonists. That's why I do so many positive reviews these days. Because I'd rather people find out about new things that they should check out than have people watch a video and say, haha, that thing's stupid. I'm glad I never saw that. I'm never going to check it out. Even like you said, Marmaduke, which is a So Bad It's Good movie, there's at least reason for me to go check that out sometime soon if I want some stupid, cheesy thing to laugh at. And that means more exactly. to me than finding something that I say, this is the worst thing ever, and I'm glad I never saw it.
Right.
So.
Right, yeah.
That's...
I like you, man. We should hang out sometime.
We should. Once I have free time and I'm done with those massive textbooks, wherever I put through them.
Yeah,
I can find those before the test.
That. Yeah, have fun with that.
I
want to
thank you all
for
inviting me on. I've had a blast, and this was immensely fun.
No problem.
Thanks for listening. Make sure you subscribe to this channel for more episodes of the podcast Cinema Royale. If you are not subscribed to Comic Strip Critic, go ahead, check him out. Worth every minute of your time. Other than that, good night.
See you later, dudes.
Ciao for now, y'all.
Alright, thank you. Bye.
Peace.